I shut it off.
We'll see how this goes. I may not even need this. We'll see if we need it or not. There are copies of the warrant articles up front here for those who might need. $5,600,000 small, there's an increase in the RGS. There's increases and decreases to go along. And I'm not sure how much detail you all want, but these are the notes. These are pretty much the notes from the front of the budget the way it's presented. So it talks a little bit about there are increases due to health premiums. Keep that in mind. There are increases due to health premiums currently in the budget. We've had some decreases in Marshall. Special education is always a very difficult thing to budget. Pam and her team do an excellent job trying to anticipate, based on where things stand today, try to anticipate what they're going to look like in the following year. One of the most difficult pieces we've had in anticipating special education costs is special education costs in Marshwood. We used to get, so at the beginning of this year, we realized we got the twice a year for special education, twice a year. So we're setting up budgets sometimes with never having seen a special education budget. And we've seen, I believe, three when we set up this year's special education cup. But the SAU team, Pam was very much a part of that, negotiated with Marshall and said, let's get that bill monthly so we can really be reconciling it every month and getting a better handle on what we're actually paying every month so that we can get better at predicting as well. So that was a big help, I think, and we'll find out as we go forward with that. I'm going to just go quickly through these slides. One of the things to point out is that our SAU assessment, that's the amount of money that Rollinsford pays to the central office for all the work they do there, has gone up this year. And it's gone up because the SAU board, which is comprised of the Summersworth School Board and the Rollinsford School Board, voted to reduce our fund balance, the SAU fund balance, and release it back to Summersworth and back to Rollinsford, some of it, most of it, back to Summersworth and back to Rollinsford, because Summersworth needed it. They had a shortfall in their current budget, and they needed that money. So to that end, we have some anticipated revenue this year that is coming in because of that. So we'll realize the savings in this year, the FY18 budget. School administration, we'll come back to more questions. One of the other changes we're making here in Rollinsford is that we're trying to get to the right size for a custodial staff. Over the last few years, we have right-sized the teaching and the educational staff, but now we're working on trying to get the custodial staff right-sized. As we take more work in-house, our facilities director, Dick Fortier, keeps an amazing eye on the building, does a lot of work, and has brought more of that work in-house. And as we do that, it's a better way for us to do the work, but we also need to make sure we have the right staff to do it. So we are indeed proposing adding a part-time custodian. You can see some of the details up there, and we'll take questions on that afterwards. There are a number of maintenance items that we have put right into the operating budget. A couple of the board decided we will address this year, out of this year's budget. We believe we'll be able to handle those easily. We hope so. The biggest item that is still in the budget is the bell and phone system. And that is still in the budget, and I'll just remind everybody again, the budget is still down from last year. It was a lower budget than we had last year. Everything else has pretty much stayed the same. I will also point out, because I bring it up when there are shifts, but the Marshwood tuition changed by a couple dollars at most. I mean, I don't think it was even a couple dollars, maybe even a dollar. So the Marshwood tuition is holding steady at this point. So here is the annual part of the budget broken out. The Rollinsford part of the budget, and including the SAU assessment in that, you can see what that is. The Marshwood budget, and then the total decrease for the year. So the Rollinsford budget is down $90,000 over last year. It's a decrease. The March with the budget is both down and up a little bit, down and up. So the total decrease over last year's operating budget is just about $73,400. Now our anticipated revenues, the second line, which says anticipated revenues, this is what we knew in November. It's over $640,000. That's from the state. That's down. They are not giving us as much this year as they did last year. So that was going to be a shortfall. But then we have the wonderful late-breaking news that we are going to get the Keno kindergarten money is about to start being distributed. We're going to get some of that this year, and that will continue as the years go on. Those X's indicate we have no idea yet what that amount is. And so what we know is that we will be getting some. We just can't anticipate what that's actually going to be. So some of the accomplishments that we've done to date, just very quickly. So with the community support, and by that I mean support for warrant articles that we've done in the past, we've completed three-phase power. That was a big hook to do for the board to get that completed. And for the school, I think they can now plug in things without wondering what's going to blow up. Abated all identified asbestos risks and replaced mandated ADA compliant lifts. Along with that, with our operational budget savings over the past number of 3 or 4 years, we've also installed lighting, upgraded plumbing, upgraded ceiling tiles, upgraded parking and playground areas, stepped up in-house maintenance of the building, stepped up efficiency of the boilers, and replaced sheds and things like that. And those last few are ideas, are examples of some of the maintenance work that has come in-house now that we don't have to farm out. And why we need to make sure we have the right staff to be able to continue to do that. So the budget not only provides an overall decrease, but allows us to continue with significant in-house maintenance. And let's see, that may be the last. Yep. So that concludes the operating budget presentation. I'm happy to take questions on the operating budget.
On the taxes on this budget, even with a decrease.
said, the revenue side is a big unknown. And so to say that that's going to be the end result is a false statement. We don't know what the end result is going to be. What we know is that the operating budget, the amount of money we need to run the school system this year, is down from last year. That's what we know. How that money gets raised is something that gets reconciled at the end of the year. And I can talk more about that as we go forward. And this is for public input, so if you could let the public have their chance here.
Celia Leopold, 426 Washington Street. I know last year and throughout the year, it's been a big deal for the staff to be on the correct tracks. Is that reflected in its budget track changes, or is it in a separate warrant article?
Good question. Is it a separate warrant article, the one that we'll be looking at next? Any other questions from public? Then we will move on. And what we're moving on to is the collective bargaining agreement. All right, so, collective bargaining agreement. Just some general comments. Both the board and the union worked very hard this year to reach this agreement. The highlights are that all teachers will be paid according to their level of experience. It's called a step in the education world and education contract world, but it equates to their years of experience. So this collective bargaining agreement makes sure that all teachers are paid according to their level of experience. The union has agreed to move to a lower cost health plan. And so there will be overall health savings. And in the next slide, you're going to see exactly what those savings will be. And it is impressive. And in order to help defray out-of-pocket costs that the staff will be incurring by going to this lower cost health care, we are also proposing a $1,000 increase to step 8. That would be the 8th year experience, which is the highest step we have here. And the paraprofessionals who are not on steps would receive a 50 cents an hour raise. The total cost at this point is just over $39,000. But let's take a look at the savings. I seem to be repeating myself. I jump ahead. But this lays out what I just talked about. Teachers at the correct experience level but pay for their experience level, paraprofessionals really to get 50 cents an hour. The health plan changed, and the next slide is really going to show you, but the projected savings for the first year, as you saw, I think, was over $47,000. By 2 years, it's $98,000 for saving, comparing it to our current plan. By the fifth year, it's $264,000 we have saved, compared to our current plan. It's pretty amazing. So this is the graph that shows that. So what we are doing is, we're at current level now, and as one of the budget committee members helped with an explanation the other night, our plan is currently a Cadillac plan. We're paying for a Cadillac, so we're right up here, driving the Cadillac along and paying for the Cadillac. However, this negotiation brings that down to, we're going to buy a VW, and it's going to be a lot less expensive to drive. It's going to be a lot less expensive to use. So we've dropped our base by a considerable amount of money, over about $48,000. This graph shows what happens when you drop your base. And even if we assume a 5% increase, I think the next slide shows that if you assume a 5% increase, you actually get more and more savings as the years go by compared to the current plan. And yes, some people will say, but wait a minute, why do we have to pay $39,000 to do that? Well, we have to buy the Volkswagen. Once we buy the Volkswagen, we start seeing all those savings. going to this lower cost health plan. This is a wonderful thing for the union to be doing and for the town to consider doing too, because it's a savings. There's no other question about it. It's a savings. I think that is pretty much it on the collective bargaining agreement. Other questions?
John Sandler, Water Street, Robinson, New Hampshire. The paraprofessionals, do they get holidays from the student?
They get holidays, yes, some.
They get snow days.
Snow days are not paid days, by the way, just so you know. No one comes to work on a snow day, but if you look at a school calendar, teachers are paid for the days that they work. If school is not held on a certain day, they have to make that up. Teachers do not get just paid for not coming to work, nor do the paraprofessionals.
Probably don't get much personal time.
Yes, they do get personal time.
So they
not personal.
But only the professional staff gets most of that time. It can be a misconception. The contract reads that teachers are paid for a number, and paraprofessionals, for a number of days of work. That means those have to be working days. Some of those working days are indeed used for other things, but there has to be, by law, there has to be so much instructional time being given. And if there's a snow day, that time has to be made up. They get teachers' workshop as part of their contract. Yes. Professional day. We call it professional development, actually. Any questions? Any other further questions? Okay. Well, we'll just move right along. Collective bargaining agreement. Needless to say, I guess I should be saying that after each one. The school board strongly recommends, passage of the operating budget, which is a savings over last year, and we strongly recommend the passage of the collective bargaining agreement, which we think the union and the board did an excellent job coming up with this agreement. So the next one is a warrant article for a total of $93,000 to replace the roof. The flat roof that's out behind you here in the annex and the kindergarten. This roof was called out in the IBEA study, some of you remember, from about 4 or 5 years ago now. The annex roof was due to be replaced in 2012 based on the IBEA study. The seams were due to be repaired right around that time, and the kindergarten roof was due to be repaired actually this year in 2018. So the warrant article is here so that we can get all that done at once, so we don't have to worry about doing a seam separately, get everything done at once, and get ourselves out ahead of anything that might happen. Flat roofs, as many of us know, are notorious for a number of things. Very important that this roof stays intact. So, again, the board is strongly recommending this one. Are there questions on this? The next warrant article is one that many of you are used to seeing on the warrant. No money needs to be raised by taxation. It is continuing to add to the building reserve fund. We do have some big ticket items coming down the line. One of the things that the school board, with the help of Principal Lucas and Dick Fortier, the building facilities guy, is to start looking forward to the things that have to happen. And we do CIP fund. So the money is not raised by taxation. This is money that will go into this fund out of any surplus we might have in this year's budget. So are there questions on this warrant article? We're looking at boiler replacement. We're looking at an entrance reconfiguration that is more secure and also more accessible. We're looking at building ventilation and the main building window replacement. And they're all within the $300,000 to $400,000 range. Each one of those is in that range. So those are the types of things we're trying to put some money aside for now when we have it to help offset cost in the future. Any other questions?
Nathaniel, do you have what the current balance is in the capital reserve fund?
Yes, another good question. The current balance is just over 100,000. It's 103,480. It's just over 100,000 right now. And the last warrant article, we'll be talking about here this morning, has to do with establishing a tuition trust fund. Currently, those of you who have read the budget very closely know that we budget for a few contingency students for Marshwood. The tuition is about $10,000. The very first year we went to Marshwood, we were woefully underfunded because little did we know that 15 new high school and middle school students were going to move to Rollinsford that we had to pay for. So since then, we started plugging in a few contingency students. The problem with having that in the operating budget is that then that becomes money in the operating budget that can be raised, that has to be raised by taxation. What we would like to do is establish a trust fund so that we can get it out of the operating budget, take it up to a level, I don't know what the board will decide, 20,000, 30,000, just give us some room to for contingency students to do that, but get it out of the operating budget is our plan. So are there questions on the establishment of this? Okay, well, that concludes the formal presentation. Now the budget committee will welcome any comments or concerns you might want to raise.
Here.
have to put the full amount of what we need to run the district, regardless, with no revenue counted in. None, zero, no revenue counted in. We have to put the full amount in the warrant article. Because if for some reason we didn't get the taxation, or we didn't get anticipated revenue, that's what we would have to, that's what we would have to pay. So that has to go on there. However, it changes all along. And I'm going to give you an example from this year, because that's what I have the figures for. This year being in November, the Department of Revenue Administration adjusted what the town had to pay to meet the school's bill for 2018. That's this year, for 2018. Because when all that got reconciled, the school had returned, did not need to raise in revenue $120,000. So your tax rate went down in December by $120,000 overall, because the school and the board decided to return a little bit extra, returned $120,000 to the town. So it's very complex to say that. It's complex. It's not as simple. Believe me, I wish it were simple, as someone was trying to make it out, but it's not. It's very complex, and we really don't know the full impact until the end of the school year. That's it. I will now just have the budget committee here published. Thank you.
I just have a question. I see, you have to excuse me, I've had to run it in and out because of my children. But I see no more articles for special ed. Are we at our limit for special ed? Are we not putting any money in our special ed capital reserve fund this year?
Excellent question. We are not putting any money in our special ed capital reserve fund this year. We are at about $170,000, and we feel that that is enough cushion. Now, special ed, as many of you know, can have a swing from $20,000 to $200,000. I mean, it could be a huge swing, and that's for one student. If indeed that were to happen. But at the moment, we feel $170,000 is a big enough amount, therefore we are not planning to put any in.
I see that there's a capital improvement reserve fund. Is there a capital improvement plan designed by the school board or the town to go along with that fund, and is it available to the public to review when we will know what big expenditures are coming up in the future for the school?
Excellent question, and we keep vowing to do a real capital improvement plan. We do have things laid out. The items I mentioned before are laid out, and three of them, the boiler, the entrance reconfiguration, and the ventilation are coming up very quickly in the next few years. So we have to look at that more closely and try to get more precise on exactly when they're going to happen.
And excuse me if you're repeating yourself in response to the question, but how long has it been since the town has passed the collective bargaining unit and given the teachers what they have requested in negotiations?
Yes, now remember, no one gets exactly what they want in negotiations. I mean, we can all agree to that. Believe me, the union wanted more, and the school board wanted more. Negotiations is about finding a wonderful place in the middle where we can all agree to support it, and that it helps. We both left a little disappointed, let's just say. But nevertheless, it is a good agreement. So, but the last time one was passed was the 14-15 school year. That was the last time a collective bargaining agreement was passed. We have not passed a collective bargaining agreement six of the last 9 years.
And what does that do to our teaching staff? Does maybe as a voter, it would be nice to see previous years, whether you recommended or not recommended, what was on the ballot, so that we could see how the voters went with your suggestions. Because you
that,
have
that, that is on the ballot. That is on the ballot.
Well, no, it's not last year's. It's not on here, so we can't see if the voters took their considerations.
It's on the annual report, though. You can see it in there.
Okay.
Any further questions?
To Kim's point, by removing those capital items out of the operating budget, moving forward every year, would that make the operating budget more consistent and not so fluid? We have your budgeting for capital improvements, you've got a capital improvement fund, but it will make it more consistent throughout the years by doing it this way?
Well, if I understand it correctly, I'm going to ask the business administrator, when it comes in, it goes in the operating budget, correct?
That's the problem.
When you vote to approve something, then it becomes part of that year's operating budget.